Pooja, could you say a few words?
Few words?
Few words.
Few words?
No.
Okay, hello everybody.
I just wanted to kind of, if you can carry people through your journey as to why you got into what you got into, because there are not many people like you. So it would be really interesting.
Each of us is unique. Each one of us has our lovely journey. But yes, thank you, Anu. Thank you so much. All right. A little bit about me. She's already given a brief about my foray into film and television and writing and the awards and the glamour angle, etc., etc. What is lesser known about me is that I come from a family with very incredible perspectives and beliefs and practices. My grandfather, who was my father's father, was a healer. He was an energy healer. He's extremely well known in Italy. He's no more, but his work lives on in the Institute, which is just above Venice in Cittadella. He healed thousands of people with energy work. And there should be lines of people outside his home going down the block waiting to be healed by Baba Bedi. I never understood it then. I thought it was all mumbo jumbo. It was fascinating. It was interesting to see all these people come forward, but I never understood it. And I am an extremely left-brained, logical person, although there's a highly creative side, clearly. But I always dealt with energy work with a great degree of skepticism. My mother, full of, you know, stories and religion and the whole, you know, philosophies of Karl Marx and, you know, I mean, and Freud and Erica Jong and Jay Krishnamurti and Osho. So I grew up with all these thoughts and attitudes and belief systems and new perspectives and open your mind and all of that. My grandmother, my father's mother, English lady who fought the freedom struggle in India along with my grandfather, being British, they met in Oxford. They got married. And post having three beautiful children, she decided to chuck everything up and join the monastery. She was the first Buddhist, she was the first woman to be inducted into the Buddhist monastery in Sikkim under His Holiness the 16th Kalpa. And she basically devoted her entire life. She shaved her head, she put on these beautiful Buddhist robes, and she's responsible for the spread of Buddhism to the West. She taught the monks English, sent them off to Scotland. And she's mentioned in every Buddhist book. Her name is Sister Pamo, also known as Frida Bedi. There is an institute, a nunnery that she has in Trilokpur in Dharamshala. And the latest book, Dharma King, which is published by His Holiness the 17th Karmapa, has about 20 photographs or 30 photographs of her in it with His Holiness the 16th Karmapa, because she was an integral part of the whole Buddhist movement in India and the spread to the West. So there's all this energy work, and you hear about Tibetan chanting and Buddhist chanting, and you grew up in a family that's got all this happening. And my left logical brain says, yeah, it's all very interesting, but, you know, I don't believe any of this. But there's this fascination, right? Because it's all around you, and everyone's believing in it and talking about it all the time. So it's in your system, but your brain very clearly says, until I'm proved that this is correct, I'm not going to actually believe it. And then these dramatic incidents keep happening in my life, clearly by some cosmic design, having a good laugh at my expense, which constantly kept forcing me to take another look. And I said, there has to be some sort of method to this madness. And I started exploring these sciences. And over the last 10 years, I've researched, as she mentioned, all these different modalities, just out of curiosity, sheer curiosity. And I started exploring whether it was shamanism or Reiki and doing energy work and understanding it better. And you realize that things happen which you can't explain, but which are absolutely real. Now, if somebody else told you about these experiences, you'd be like, what? What nonsense? When they happen to you, it's not nonsense anymore. I'll give you just a small example. When I was doing hypnosis, and we talk about past lives, right? So you're given the ability to take people into their past lives because past lives affect current lives. So you're like, yeah, really? What if I just have a really good imagination? What if it's my imagination that creates my past life? What if when they take you into hypnotherapy, that all you're doing is just using a very creative aspect of your brain and visualizing something? And this was always at the back of my mind, that it could be my imagination because my left brain doesn't want to believe it. It's not logical. How can there be a past life and all those memories come into this life? It's not logical, right? And then I'm sitting one day at my hypnotherapy class. And by then, we've done about four different scripts going to the past life. And as as usual, you go on the cloud, you land in that lifetime, your feet go down, you embed yourself in that lifetime. And the demo is going on stage with one of the students. And I'm there, I'm in the room, and watching this. And I'm in the room, but I have this visual going on in the back of my head somewhere in some other zone simultaneously where I can see mountains, snow-capped mountains. And the guy says, yes, I see snow-capped mountains. At which point, I look at him, wondering whether it was a mistake. I look around because I know sir is going to say, what else do you see in this particular time zone or time frame or what's around you? And I can see a wooden house in the distance. And I look at him and the guy under hypnotherapy, he says, oh, I can see a wooden house in the distance. And I'm freaked out. And I know sir is automatically now going to say, open the door, go inside and see what's happening in the house. That's obviously the next step. So I, in my head, I'm suddenly in that house and I see this woman in this long dress, long hair, cooking on the stove. And now I'm waiting, I'm looking at the man, well, what's he going to say now? And he says, there's a woman cooking on the stove. At this point, I'm completely freaked out, okay? And the session ends, and sir says, any questions? And I say, yes, I have a question. It's his past life. How can I see his past life? It's not my past life. And then he talks to you about collective consciousness and how we are essentially down here, but there's a collective pool of consciousness up there which is constantly giving us these messages. You know, when you talk about intuition and we talk about, I just knew it, I should have listened to my inner voice, et cetera, which I discussed during my courses. And you realize that all the higher selves are up there in a pool of collective consciousness, and you can at any point, like Google, go up there, Google anything, and be in anyone's collective consciousness and access it. So that then proves to me that we have past lives, because there's no way I'd be able to see something he experienced unless it was actually there. So in simple little ways, the universe keeps showing me that things do exist when my logical brain refuses to accept it. And this is not just one-off incident. This has happened to me numerous times in numerous ways. So I know that there's some design out there that's constantly showing me something, and clearly for a reason. So as I started putting everything together, all these courses, figuring out, you know, a lot of people here are super professional in their field. They know their field so well. Each person has their own science in this room and this incredible bank of knowledge that comes with each one's particular specialized area of work and expertise. And it's mind-blowing. And then you kind of figure out, like someone like me, who's like a jack of all trades, but a master of none, okay? I've become a master of being a jack of all trades. So it's you know, you kind of see where in the energy grid all of this fits in, where every single science, be it energy work through Reiki and shamanism and all of that, where it fits into, and where science will validate certain things, where, for example, hypnotherapy fits into the picture, where NLP would fit into the picture, where a past life experience would fit into the picture. And you kind of see the entire grid, you see the entire matrix of energy and how everything is working simultaneously to create our experiences, our life, our thoughts, our bodies, our journey, why we're here, all of that comes into the picture. And this was completely fascinating to me. And my Happy Soul workshops that I've started are basically for all those people out there that have no clue, that wonder, just like I did, that want access to all of this in a way that is tangible, that is logical, where they can understand all of that, but very simply put. Because we can make it confusing and we can make it complicated and we can go into such details that it'll jangle your brains and you'll be fried. You'll be like, it's too much information, I can't handle it. Or you can actually say it so simply, because it is actually really simple. It's actually so simple to understand how energy works. So it's, thank you. So, you know, and that's what the course is about. That's what I'm going to share with you this afternoon also in one of the journeys that I'm going to take you through. It's a very interesting energetic journey that I'm going to be, whoever's going to be there for it. It's a called reorientation meditation, which explains to you before that what energy is, how you are interconnected with people energetically, and how you can change that, how you can completely change your energy cord with somebody. I've had amazing results with this meditation. I've had people come up to me, post that, and say, I've carried hatred in my heart for this person for 10 years. How is it possible 2 days later that I'm not feeling any of it? It's not possible. It feels strange to be without this hatred. How could it disappear so quickly? Things like that. I had at my last workshop, the sponsor Anil G, he'd come. He stayed for the entire meditation. And he comes to me and he says, it's unbelievable. He says, I did this meditation with a very fractured relationship. He says, it was such a bad relationship. And he comes to me with his phone. He says, this person has just called me. how is it possible that in 20 minutes of having done this meditation, the person has actually called me? So it can work as quickly as that if you allow it to. Because the only person that stops you from everything out there is you. So the more you open your minds, as we all are clearly open-minded because we're all open to mental health, it's a wonderful bunch of people here. I can't wait to hear what all of you are going to be saying today. I'm so sorry. I'd love to have stayed longer. But I have to be in Bangalore tomorrow for Happy Soul and Gurgaon, Delhi day after for Happy Soul. So I'm going to miss listening to these amazing people and sharing their journeys. I'm going to ask for the video, Anu, so I can actually catch up on everything that I've missed. And thank you all for being here. Thank you for sharing. I look forward to learning whatever I can. And thank you all so much. And thank you, Anu. Anu has been such a sweetheart. This lady has really put in a heart, energy, mind, body, soul, everything into healing herself, people, the planet, and all of that. And we can only salute and egg on people like her. So well done, Anu.
A very special thanks to Pooja for two reasons. The first time that I went and I actually spoke to her and said, will you please come and help us? She said, sure, come over. And I was like really, really surprised because, I mean, Bollywood stars are supposed to be, and they're not supposed to do all that, right? They're not supposed to be, that's the image that you have. Believe me, this lady has such a golden heart. All I had to do was, Pooja, can I come and meet you? Yeah. I said, where? Hospital. So our story began with reaching hospital. Her son was lying down in the bed, and I just looked at her and said, this is Meta Health, and I just rattled off, I think. And soon there was this garden outside. And she looks in the hospital. This is what she says. Her son is lying down with a fractured bone here. She's smiling and looking out and saying something. And I look out and say, this is beautiful. And she says, doesn't it look like a resort? It's the positive attitude. And she had her workshop that was due. And she did not even have a frown on her face saying, oh God, I'm going to cancel the workshop. I asked her, are you going to cancel it? Of course, my son is not well. Of many mothers who would have said, no, I have to be the sacrificial one. I'm the single mom. I have to do this, that, and that. But nothing. I did not see a frown on her face. And she so gracefully agreed to be here. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.